I've got a week off work, which means I got to watch Raw live, and I wish I didn't. Welcome to episode 7, where we're going to talk about happier wrestling things, such as the G1. I had to mention Raw because it was so fucking bad, but that will come later in the week. Today is all about the G1, because that's the happy time of wrestling, not Raw. Raw was bad. I'm going to go through nights 1 and 2. So A block was night 1, B block was night 2. And then I'll recap both those, and then I will preview night 3 and 4, which is the second night for A and B block respectively. As I said, I'm not going to mention Raw until I do my Raw and SmackDown recaps later in the week, but it's gonna be fun because it was fucking horrible. So yeah, hopefully SmackDown's better, because otherwise that's gonna be a real clusterfuck of a show to do. But I'll get there. I'll always get there. Well, G1 started over the weekend. Happy days. And it kicked off. Now, I'm not going to touch on the Young Lion matches. This is strictly G1 matches. So, be 5 per show. Goes just over 2 hours. Highly recommended if you want good wrestling. If you want shit wrestling, you watch Raw. But, anyway. Kicked off with Will Ospreay back in Japan after sitting at home in the UK for so long. Love him or hate him, it was good to see him back in a New Japan ring. A lot of people don't agree with what he's done outside the ring, or what he may or may not have done or been accused of, you know, etc. But I personally don't worry about all that outside stuff. I watch him strictly as a pro wrestler. What he does inside the ring is amazing, so that's what I judge him on. And inside the ring, he's really, really good. So, yeah, it was good to see him back. As good as it was to see Will Ospreay back, it was equally as odd to see Yujiro Takahashi in the G1. Because he has no right being there. But I digress. People like Bad Luck Fale have taken up a spot in previous years, so no harm, no foul. Respectable match to open the tournament, to be honest. Was nothing too, over the top. Was nothing. It wasn't bad. It was respectable. Will got the win, so that's 2 points in the bank for Will. Takahashi will probably not win a whole lot, if at all. So. But yeah, I hope this is the beginning of a good G1 for Will, because I think he needs to push on at the start of next year and start looking towards becoming like an IC or a US champion, because, I would assume he will win the heavyweight title at some point, whether it be next year or the year after. But yeah, he'll climb the mountain eventually. It's just a matter of when. I think an IC or a US title run sort of early next year will probably be where he should be aiming after a really respectable G1 campaign. After the match, he grabbed the microphone in the ring, claimed that he's the best pro wrestler in the world right now. That's always going to be arguable. Like, it's always going to be an opinion question. Some people might say that he's right, others might say no fucking way. I don't think he is, personally, but at the end of the day, he's really good. So he's definitely got a claim to it, but for me, he's not. But you're always going to have people that say, oh yes, he is, or no, someone else is, or blah blah. It's always going to be a water cooler question, so yeah, it is what it is. Match 2 was really fun to watch. A lot of people don't like Tai Chi. He's getting better. He's getting better. And they obviously think highly of him. So, but yeah, Tai Chi, Jeff Cobb. Yeah, as I said, heck of a lot of fun to watch. When he's got the right opponent, Tai Chi, he can actually create a lot of magic in the ring. It's all a matter of opinion with him. Either love him or you hate him. He's had the rip off the pants gimmick and the singing gimmick for a long time. A lot of people love when Angel Garza takes off the pants, but they hate when Tai Chi takes off the pants. I don't get it, but yeah, Tai Chi's not for me. But geez, this was not a pussyfooting match. They didn't hold back. So Tai Chi gets the win over Jeff Cobb. Surprised me a little bit, but I still don't know if Jeff Cobb's actually signed to New Japan. Like, I heard he is, but I can't say for sure. So, if he's not, it makes sense for Tai Chi to get the win, because he's all the way in New Japan. But, you know, it wouldn't have shocked me if Jeff Cobb had a one either, but yeah, 2 points to Tai Chi on opening night. It's always a good thing. As Jeff Cobb's no mug. Losing to Tai Chi may mean Cobb is going to have a hard time in A block, because it's an actual legit murderer's row. But other than Tai Chi, like, Tai Chi is probably like second bottom of the shitness in A block, and he just lost to him. The only other one that's worse is Yujiro. So Cobb will probably beat Takahashi. Other than that, I think he's going to struggle for a win. But fuck, he's going to have some slappers on the way. He may not win a whole lot, but gee boy, he's going to put on some bangers. And that's fine. Excuse me. I'm happy with that. Third match of the night. And we already saw two guys trying to murder each other. Not literally. Figuratively. But boy, oh boy, did Suzuki and Ishii beat the shit out of each other. Like, Ishii doesn't know any other way. Like, go back and watch, you know, some of his matches from, like, Wrestle Kingdom 10, I think it was. Ishii and Shibata just absolutely beat the piss out of each other. Ishii doesn't hold back. Guy's got no neck. Tells you everything you need to know. Fucking weapon. But anyway, yeah, so, and anyone that calls himself Murder Grandpa, you know they're a scary motherfucker, and that's exactly what Minoru Suzuki is. What gets me every time I watch Minoru Suzuki wrestle, it's his facials, like the faces he pulls while he's dishing out abuse as well as taking abuse. It's fucking ridiculous. The guy's 50. And if you saw him in the street, you'd fucking run away, because he's a scary, scary man. He's probably a teddy bear, but he just looks so scary. It's just ridiculous. But anyway, I actually thought Ishii would win this and set up a never title match somewhere down the line, and then Suzuki would win. But Suzuki gets the win off the Gotch pile driver, banks in nearly 2 points. Suzuki, I don't know. It's, again, this is an actual murderer's row of a block. Suzuki, now he's beaten Ishii. I would probably say he beats Tai Chi. He would definitely beat Yujiro. So there's 6 points. I don't see that he wins any matches after that. Oh, he might beat Shingo. But Shingo, having Suzuki beat Shingo at the power struggle at the stadium the other month, they might give Shingo a win back there. But that's the best thing about New Japan. You just don't know. If you can honestly tell me who is accurately going to win every 5 block matches per night and then go on to win this whole thing, you're a liar. You have no idea, like the rest of us. Because A block is stacked. Absolutely stacked. There's no way to accurately predict who's finishing on top of this block. Absolutely not. But we're going to have a lot of fun getting there. Three matches in and I was already having a good time. By this point, we'd probably, you know, the broadcast had been going probably 40, 45 minutes and I was ready for more. I watched 40, 45 minutes of Raw this morning and I was ready to fall fucking asleep. Anyway, Jay White, Shingo, Takagi. I was really looking forward to this match. Why? Because I love Jay White. Takagi's good too. Really love Shingo. I thought Jay White was going to win this match, and he did. But I was actually... I was curious, is the word, curious, to see how Jay was going to go, being in such a heavy-hitting or hard-hitting match, straight up. Because he'd wrestled a couple of matches on Strong in America, but, you know, wrestling guys like Flip Gordon and stuff, and then coming to wrestling 15, nearly 20 minutes with Shingo. That's a big difference. But... heel or not, the fans love Jay White, and it showed. Like, he stood there, egged the crowd on, said, cheer for me, and they did. Why? Because they love the guy. He's stated many times, he's New Japan all the way, and that's cool. But the guy went through the dojo. He gets it. He gets it. And like Will Ospreay, it was so good to have him back in a New Japan. Like an actual Japanese New Japan ring. So good. So good. It's where he belongs. He'll be world champ again. I can't wait for that day. He's fucking yoked, man. He's ripped as fuck. He looks amazing. And Shingo's just a fucking monster. He's just a brute of a dude. Like, I loved everything about this match. Jay worked Shingo's back. And then Shingo's selling of his back was... so good, so good. Like, he went to do things and he's all like, oh, back, oh. I love that stuff, you know. Sometimes in WWE and stuff, they do it, and then they go and do other stuff and they'll be like, well, it's forgotten about. Nah, Shingo was hitting moves and then be like, oh, that hurt. That's natural. It's good. I like it. Towards the end, Shingo reversed the Blade Runner into a modified Last of the Dragon for a near fall. That was a wicked sequence. Wicked sequence. But in the end, Jay gets the Blade Runner. King Switch wins. Awesome match. Awesome match. Yeah, Jay White banks too. Shingo will win some. He'll lose some. We still get Takagi versus Ospreay again. Oh boy. Yes, please. So we'll get that somewhere down the line. But yeah, it doesn't get any easier for Jay White, as we'll find out in the preview shortly. But yeah, Jay White, 2 points. Happy days. Main event of night one. Yeah, see? Main event already. We had 6 matches in total, just over 2 hours. Oh, so good. So good. Kota Ibushi comes out first. Main event was Kota Ibushi versus Kazuchika Okada. Wrestle Kingdom rematch. If you haven't seen the Wrestle Kingdom match, like, go out of your way, find it, watch it somehow. They went, if you're not a fan of long matches, don't watch it, because you probably won't like it. If you don't care how long a wrestling match goes, watch it. Especially the sequence where Kota Ibushi goes full fucking nightmare and just beats the shit out of Okada. Like, I swear to God, he was just shooting on him and just slapping him around. Oh, that was so good. I need to watch that match again. Oof. Anyway, Ibushi comes out. I hadn't seen him for a while. Motherfucker looks like an action figure. He's abs. Absolutely. See what I did there? He's yoked as shit. He's jacked up like a motherfucker. The whole time he's walking in the ring, I'm like, this guy competed in the Cruiserweight Classic. And WWE had him in the palm of their hand. But thankfully, they fucked up. And he went, no thanks. I'm going home. So glad you did. So glad you did. And then you got Okada. He's still the biggest star in New Japan. I don't care what anyone says. Like, the guy is the Roman Reigns of Japanese wrestling. He's got the look, the ability, and in the ring, the whole nine yards. The guy is just... Like, you think current day New Japan, it's Okada, front and center. I don't care if he's the champ, I don't care if he's not the champ. It's just, he's the man. He's the man. Like, every time I think, or someone will ask me, who do you think's the best wrestler in the world at the moment? I'll be like, oh. And I get caught between favorite and best in the world. For me, bell to bell, everything in between, Okada is number one, hands down. Reigns is good. Roman Reigns is really good. But for me, Okada is just a step above. Step above. I think Okada's one, Kenny's two. I think Roman's number three. That's just me. A lot of people will beg to differ, but for me, Okada, numero uno, all day long. When they paced around the ring and they sort of stared each other down, like, the silence in that arena was actually spine-tingling. It was crazy. Like, they were taking baby steps around the ring, and you could hear the floor, the boards of the ring creaking. That's how silent it was. Such is the respect that Japanese fans have for the craft, and especially these two guys. And to me, that's just spine-tingling. It's so amazing. Ibushi reversing a dropkick into a sit-down powerbomb, and then he hits a running knee strike. Kamigoye ending sequence was amazing. I actually didn't think it was going to end there. I thought Okada would kick out, but he didn't. I'm so glad they didn't overdo the finisher after finisher after finisher, near fall after near fall after near fall, like New Japan tends to do with main events. Because being not one of the G1, don't overdo that sort of stuff. Save that till later in the tournament where we get really big matches. Not to say this isn't a big match, but this is not one of the G1. If you lose here, you're not eliminated. You're just down 2 points. So, I really enjoyed that. Ibushi winning kind of surprised me. But it was one of those matches where there's no loser. We're all winners having watched this. It wasn't as good as their Wrestle Kingdom match, but it was still a fantastic main event for any show. This could have headlined. I was going to say, this could have headlined Wrestle Kingdom, but it did. But yeah, it was an amazing match to round off Night 1. As I said, Ibushi winning did surprise me. Only because I don't think Ibushi's winning the G1 this year, having won last year. Not saying that he won't, I just don't personally think he will. But if they do, like last year, he won the G1, and I was convinced they were gonna have him win the title at Wrestle Kingdom until they changed it to the double dash ding, and I'm like, there's no way he's winning. Naito is winning this all day long. If they do have Ibushi win, they need to go all in with Ibushi at Wrestle Kingdom. They can't fuck him around. He had all the momentum in the world last year, and he went 0-2 over 2 nights. Why? I love Jay White as much as the next man, but why did? Why? So you had, at Wrestle Kingdom last year, you had Naito go 2-0, you had Okada go 1-1, Jay White go 1-1, and you had Ibushi go 0-2. Like, fair enough, it puts you at number 4 out of those killers, but the guy was white hot. It's ludicrous. He could have beaten Okada and then lost to Naito, it wouldn't have mattered. But anyway, I don't book it. Gator does a really good job of that. Yeah, if he does win it this year, they need to go all out with him. Or at least have Ibushi versus Ospreay again at Wrestle Kingdom for the IC title or US title or something, anything. Because Ibushi's a superstar. Don't jerk him around. But yeah, the top three matches were outstanding. Taichi Cobb was a lot of fun. Ospreay and Takahashi, it wasn't bad. Didn't go too long. As I said, the show only itself only went just a touch over 2 hours, I think. So nice and quick. Tell I like it. Good stuff. Night two, B block. I look at B block and I'm like, it's not as exciting to me. I'm like, oh, is B block going to be a hard watch sometimes? And it'll probably drag at certain points, but I actually thought night one was going to drag and it didn't. Night two, which is night one of B block, it didn't drag at all. I'm not a huge fan of a lot of the talent in B block, but we'll get to that. Yoshihashi versus Juice Robinson, two guys I care nothing about. Juice Robinson especially, I ain't get it. But I love how proud Yoshihashi is to finally be a title holder in New Japan. Like, he wears the never six-man tag title belt with such pride. Like, it's a six-man title, no one gives a shit about it. But he's just like, he's beaming like he's just won the world title at the biggest show in the world. It's actually good. I enjoyed that part. Japanese crowd love Juice Robinson. I don't know why. I don't get it. It could be a respect thing. Like, the guy was a fully fledged member of the NXT roster as CJ Parker, and then he goes to Japan and goes, I'm just going to go back to basics. I'm going to go to the dojo and just be a shit kicker for a while. Who does that? So maybe they respect him for that. I don't know. But he came out with this real flamboyant, well, that's what they call him over there, so man, it makes sense, but real flamboyant Emi Sakura ripoff Freddie Mercury inspired gimmick. But the crowd was eating that shit up, so man, if it works for him, good on him, I guess. Whatever, doing something right. He's dating Tony Storm, it's never bad. This match went far too long. It wasn't bad, it was just, it dragged. It just went far too long. Like, the night before, he had Ospreay versus Yujiro Takahashi. That was sort of short and to the point. This dragged on, probably 15 or so minutes. Yeah, but Juice won in the end, and that was always going to happen. But yeah, this match just went far too long. Right result, just took too long to get there. So, Juice gets 2 points. He'll move on to the next batch of matches. But yeah, neither men are for me. Speaking of people not for me, Tori Yano. Yano versus Sonata. Lots of shenanigans by the King of Pro Wrestling. Yes, he won a tournament to crown himself the King of Pro Wrestling. That happened. He gets the count out win after tying Sonata to Yamura, I think it was. And it's pretty funny seeing Sonata trying to run to a three-legged race to get to the ring to miss the count out. But Yano gets the count out win, banks 2 points, leaves Sonata on zero. Every time you think Sonata might have a good chance of winning a block, they start him off with this rubbish. Poor guy, can't catch a break. Can't beat Okada when it really matters, even though I think he beat him last year's G1, from memory. And he gets shafted by Yano in the first match, but I still think Sonata will be there when the tournament gets serious a bit later on. Yano definitely won't. But yeah, I think the further this goes, I think as it gets later in the tournament, I think that this result will be looked back on by, like, they'll make it so that Sonata looks back on this result and goes, oh, yeah, that fucked me. But we'll see. Kenta versus Hiroki Goto. As someone mentioned on Twitter, I think it was Mr. Warren Hayes, the biggest travesty of all of this G1 is the fact that Kenta cut off his his lockdown hair, his quarantine hair. It is big blonde looking mop going on over in America where he won the New Japan Cup USA. And he turns up, he's got this like grey wash through it. He cut it and it's all styled and stuff. Something that was giving him personality now is as bland as balls again. But dude can go in the ring. That's all that matters, I guess. But yeah, he cut his mop of hair off. I was disappointed with that too, but I'm glad that he's bringing the number one contender case that he won in the New Japan Cup USA. Gives him, like, he's the number one contender to Moxley's US title. So I like that they've dragged that over from Strong into this. Makes him look even more dangerous, the fact that he won a tournament to do so. Like, he beat Jeff Cobb, David Finlay, and Carl Fredericks, I think, to win the whole thing. So he didn't beat, you know, Muggs. He won some good matches to win it. So it makes him look a bit more dangerous. Makes him look, and look, the guy took Naito to the limit not long after Wrestle Kingdom. So he can go. He's a chance in B block, that's for sure. This is a really good match. Like, Kenta beat the shit out of Goto. Goto didn't really get a whole lot of offense, but didn't get a chance to get going. Kenta just blunted him from the start, but it was a really good match. To open their accounts, yeah, Goto stuck on zero. Kenta takes away the 2 points, moves on. When I saw the schedule come out, I had no idea who was winning this, but Kenta is in the midst of a push, I guess you'd call it. So that was why I felt he was winning, but having him win by submission, that was a bit of a shock for me. I didn't think he was going to win by submission, but he did. Goto tapped, or verbally admitted, whatever he did. 2 points for Kenta. Zack Sabre Jr. always looks angry at the world. Is that a UK thing? I don't know, but he always looks pissed off, and it's funny as shit. I love it. It's great. This was a heel versus heel match, but the crowd chose Zack Sabre Jr. because they don't like Bullet Club shenanigan bullshit. It's the only time New Japan tend to overbook things. It's when Bullet Club's involved. So, yeah. Evil beat the shit out of ZSJ early. Sidewall slammed him on the floor and gave it one of these. Yeah. Too easy. No problems. I actually wasn't looking forward to this match either, because Evil's a bit for me. I'm going to be in the mood for Zack Sabre Jr., and I thought him and Evil wouldn't, could be anything, but I actually really enjoyed this match. It was better than it had any right to be honest. It was interesting to see Zack Sabre Jr. play the babyface from underneath, but it actually worked because of the Bullet Club shenanigan stuff. And as such, he stole 2 points, one with a roll-up. Evil was pissed. But yeah, ZSJ banks the two and moves on. We'll see who he faces next in the preview, but yeah, good win for ZSJ. I think he actually fights Naito next, to be honest. So that'll be an interesting one, taking on the champ. But we'll see how he goes. Yeah, so Evil coming off a loss to Naito for the double titles. Starts off with a big donut, and ZSJ gets the two. So, happy days for him. Main event of night two. See, how quick do these go? WWE, take notice, you fuckers. Watching Naito walk to the ring, he looks so far out of it. He was spacey as shit. I was actually concerned for a minute, but it became clear pretty quick that he was like super focused, but he looked like he was out of it. But Hiroshi Tanahashi, like mid to late 40s, I think he's mid 40s, 43 or something like that, with the right opponent can still churn out fucking bangers. The level he competes at's ridiculous. Like, people like Jericho and Dustin Rhodes are competing in AEW, but that's nothing compared to the quality that people like Minoru Suzuki at 50 and Tanahashi at 43 or whatever he is churning out. Like, this match was like 20 odd minutes and it was never dull. It was high quality. Tanahashi just gets it, man. Just gets it. But yeah, he's adopted the cloverleaf over the last couple of years, and I really like that. I like how he gets a high angle on it, like Jericho did early days with the Walls of Jericho. Gets a real high angle on it instead of sitting down, flattening him out. It looks more painful and impactful. I like it. Towards the end of the match, I love it when they do it a fair bit. Sometimes I overdo it, but I really enjoy it. Towards the end of a match, they just, two brutes just stand there and stare each other down. They yell at each other in Japanese. Of course, I don't speak it. I've got no idea what they're saying. And they basically just say, come on, fucking hit me, hit me. And they just start fucking forearming and slapping and shit. It's basically just a cock measuring contest to see who can hit each other harder. It's just savagery. It's fucking amazing. Like, Ishii and Suzuki did it on night one, and I swear to fucking Christ, I thought Suzuki knocked Ishii the fuck out. He forearmed him and Ishii dropped like a sack of shit. As I said, that guy's got no neck, he doesn't feel anything. And Suzuki dropped him like a bag of shit. Oh, they do it all the time, and it's so good every time they do it. They probably overdo it, but I still love it every time. And Naito and Tanahashi did the same thing. They just beat the piss out of each other. It was so good. So good. It was like Max Holloway. Max Holloway does it in the UFC. Last 10 seconds of the fifth round, he goes, let's go, and then just beat the shit out of each other. Like, same deal. Fuck. Oh, crazy people. Crazy people. Naito's timing, moving out of the high fly flow, was impeccable. Impeccable. Like, Tanahashi missed him by this much. Like, the size of Gooch. So small. But hard fought victory for the ungovernable champion, Naito. 2 points to open. Tanahashi. Look, I love Tanahashi, and he's had a lot of success over the years. I think his role in this G1 is to have a lot of these type of matches, like really good, high quality matches with good opponents, but I don't think he's going to win a whole lot of them. And he's probably fine with that. And I'm fine with that. But if he has these sort of matches with your Juice Robinsons and your Yoshihashis and your Sonatas and your Gotos and Kentas and stuff, and just puts them over, happy days. Tanahashi, mate, you could pin him a million times in 1 week. It's not going to matter. So, and they know that. So, yeah, that's probably what they'll do. But yeah, that was the first two nights. Night two for me wasn't as good as night one, but still very good. But if you're comparing the two, night one stand out, because A block's always going to be better. It's very rare B block's going to have a better night than A block. But yeah, it was what it was. So after one night each of each block, we had Kota Ibushi's on 2 points, Will Ospreay's on 2 points, Minoru Suzuki 2 points, Taichi 2 points, Jay White 2 points, which means Jeff Cobb, Okada, Tomohiro Ishii, Shingo Takagi, Yujiro Takahashi, all on 0. I think Takahashi's donut might stay for a little bit. I honestly don't know who's wrestling next, but I can't see him beating. I look at the list of who's in A block, and Yujiro Takahashi ain't beating fucking anybody. I actually think he wrestles Okada next, and there's no way he's beating Okada. No way. Especially not after Okada lost to Ibushi. Please. B block. So after one night, you got Juice Robinson, 2 points. Yanu with 2 points. Naito, 2 points. Zack Sabre Jr., 2 points. And Kenta, 2 points. Which means Hiroshi Tanahashi, Hiroki Goto, Yoshihashi, Sanada, and Evil are all on donuts. Yeah, I think Yoshihashi's donut might stay for a bit there too, but, you know, he's there. He might win I don't know, they might have him beat Tanahashi. I wouldn't hate it. Why not? Doesn't hurt anyone. But yeah, that was night one and two. Done and dusted. Night three is actually, it's 1 a.m. so it's tonight for me. Is night three. I don't know what day it is for everybody else, but night three is today for me. First match of night three. A block. Jeff Cobb versus Shingo Takagi. Oof. They've met once before. G1 last year. Jeff Cobb won. I don't think that's going to happen again. I think Shingo will win this one. And he will bank his first 2 points, and Jeff Cobb will stay on at zero. But I wouldn't surprise me if Jeff Cobb won either. So if I had to guess, I would say Shingo wins. Yep, going with Shingo, 100%. Yeah, I reckon this will be a good match. Good match. All of A-Box matches will be good. But the match last year, I'm trying to remember it. I think they just beat the piss out of each other, as they always do. New Japan doesn't know any other way. But yeah, Shingo will win, in my opinion. He'll take the two. He'll get his account going, and Jeff Cobb will remain on zero. Not much to say about the next one. Okada vs. Yujiro Takahashi. They've met 3 times before. Okada's 3-0. Twice in the G1. Make it 3 times in the G1, because Okada's going to win. Next. Oh, actually. Yeah, nah. These two were just feuding not long ago. Okada beat him easily. And then he beat him in a handicap match. So, yeah. Sorry, Yujiro. You can just fuck off to being a Tokyo pimp. And, yeah, just piss right off. Okada, we'll bank 2 points, thanks. I actually couldn't believe when I read this. Suzuki and Taichi, first New Japan singles meeting. Wow. Well, actually, no, I lie. They met back in 2016, but Taichi's different now. Way different. I'm gonna say Taichi wins. I don't know why. Actually, I do know why. I think Taichi's gonna win and get a shot at the NEVER title and then get absolutely murdered by Suzuki. That'd be good. Otherwise, if Suzuki wins, they're sort of positioning him to only lose to the Jay Whites, the Ibushis, etc. Actually, no, I lie. Suzuki's winning. I can't see Taichi beating Suzuki. I lied. I'm sorry. I don't make a habit of it, I promise. Yeah, Suzuki. I don't know what the match is going to be like. I've got no idea. I just hope Suzuki slaps the shit out of him, because I'll laugh. He's blonde. Taichi's blonde fringe will just go everywhere, and it'll be funny. But yeah, I reckon Suzuki. I'm confident now. Now, this is a legit first time ever. Never wrestled each other in singles match. Tomohiro Ishii vs. Will Ospreay. Oof. I'm looking forward to this one. I think Ishii is going to win. I'll tell you why. Ospreay won on opening night. Ishii lost on opening night. I think Ishii will win and they'll be 1-1 each, which is cool. because I don't think either of these two are going to win A-Block. But Will Ospreay is the RevPro British Heavyweight Champion, a title which can be defended in New Japan. I think Ishii will win. Ishii will then go on to wrestle Ospreay for that title, in which Ospreay will avenge the loss. That is my prediction. Ishii will bank 2 points. Next. Oh, the main event. Oh, yeah. Oh, boy. G1 Final 2019 rematch. Kota Ibushi versus Jay White. I've got no idea. I really don't. Ibushi won the G1 Final against Jay White last year in a slapper of a match. Jay White beat Ibushi at Wrestle Kingdom. As such, I've got no idea. But I'm here to make predictions, so I'm going to go Jay White because I like him better. I actually do think Jay White will win for no other reason than I think he's going to win the whole thing. Yeah. I just hope it's a fucking slapper again, because they're capable of it. And Jay White's rise from Young Lion to how good he is ridiculous. I remember when he first came back from excursion to challenge Tanahashi for the IC title at Wrestle Kingdom that year. Because I hadn't been, I wasn't watching New Japan flat out when he got sent away. When he came back, I was like, who the fuck's this guy? And then I sort of snubbed their match at Wrestle Kingdom and I was like, oh shit. I went back and watched not too long ago. It was actually pretty good. Jay White's no joke. Neither's Ibushi, so. Yeah, I think Jay White will win because I think he's winning the whole thing. But it wouldn't surprise me if Ibushi won. I just want a good match. I don't really care who wins. I don't really care who wins. They can't fuck up whoever they pick to win. But I think Jay White, maybe via some shenanigans due to some BC activity, but we'll see. We'll see. But yeah. That's tonight for me. Maybe tomorrow for everyone else. I don't know. But night four will be the night after, because three comes after four. Yeah, that's how it works. Opening match of B Block night two, so night four in total. Will be Hiroki Goto versus Sanada. Goto just got battered by Kenta and Sanada got shafted by Yano. Alright, if you asked me before the tournament started whether Sanada or Goto would go Norton 2 after two matches, I'd be like, get the fuck out of here, no. Someone's gonna. I think Sanada will win. I think they're positioning Sanada on a higher level than Goto, and which is sad because Goto is good, man. So good. I remember, for those of you who don't remember, Goto was who Kenny Omega beat to win the G1 a few years back. Yeah, Kenny won the thing, beating Goto in the final. Go figure. Go figure. And that was a good match. Real good. But yeah, I think Sonata wins. And Goto will be still on donuts. Sonata will be 2 points. Or as they say in basketball, 2 points. The overall record between this next matchup is fucking ludicrous. But apparently they've been battling for 15 years at this point. So New Japan's website says. Jesus Christ. Tanahashi versus Toriyano. I think Tanahashi wins. Overall singles record between these two is 15-3-2 to Tanahashi. So I think that's 15 wins to Tanahashi, 3 losses, 2 countouts maybe. I don't know how they worked that, but Tanahashi's winning this, I think. Jeez. If Yano went 2 from 2 and had 4 points, and Tanahashi and potentially Sanada or Goto had 0, I'd be like, what? But surely not. Surely not. Tanahashi wins. That's my prediction. Next, 2 former NXT guys throwing down. Juice Robinson versus Kenta. First New Japan singles meeting, apparently. Kenta goes 2-0. Juice goes to 1-1. Yep, Kenta wins. Kenta will win, I believe. I think he's just positioned on a bit of a higher level than Juice at the moment. I don't know what kind of match these two are going to have. I actually can't sort of picture. Juice can take a beating. He can dish out a beating too. So it'll be pretty hard hitting, I would assume. But I think Kenta's going to go 2-0. Juice will go 1-1. So 4 points for Kenta after this. Juice will stay on 2. Yeah, I think we're all... I don't think Kenta's going to win the G1. Because I think they might hold off his challenge briefcase thingy until Wrestle Kingdom, potentially. Already in September, nearly October. January's only a couple months away. Why the fuck not? Hold it out. Let's do it. Those two are going to beat the shit out of each other. I'm so here for that. Oh, boy. But yeah, Kenta wins. Not a whole lot to say about the next one. Yoshihashi versus Evil. Evil will win. Evil will win. He needs to win. He needs to win. Yeah, after this, Evil will be 1-1 on 2 points. Yoshihashi will be 0-2 on donut points. Evil to win next. Main event. I thought this was a fait accompli that Naito was going to win. Then I saw the record, and they're 2-2. There you go. I don't know. Oh, I like the fact that these main events, you just don't know. Don't know. Night 3, Jay White and Ibushi, you just don't know. Naito and Zack Sabre Jr., I don't know. I'm going to pick Zack Sabre Jr. for the same reason I picked Ishii to beat Ospreay on Night 3. Yep. Throughout the G1, the champ will normally lose a handful of matches, or one or two matches, or whatever. And whoever beats him in those matches generally ends up getting a title match at some point. I think Zack Sabre will be numero uno in that line. I think Zack Sabre will win. And I think he will challenge Naito at the next big event after this. I don't know what that is. Power Struggle, maybe? Where Naito will beat him. That's my prediction for that one. I think Zack Sabre will go to 4 points. And I think Naito will stay at 2. That's my assumption. And that's what Night 4 will be. Or bring. So that will be that. That's my G1 night 1 and 2 recap and night 3 and 4 preview. Yeah, I'll continue to do these as the G1 goes on. Hopefully I'll be able to do them as often. I go back to work next week, so watching the shows becomes harder, but I will do my ever-loving best. I will be back later in the week for an NXT and AEW recap show, and then I will be back a couple more days after that where I'll do a Raw and SmackDown show. And on the end of that show, I will do Clash of Champions predictions. That's what I will be doing. Because Clash of Champions is next weekend, or this weekend coming. Yeah, and I think TakeOver is the weekend after. And that's funny, everyone on Twitter today was like, oh, I'm looking forward to Clash of Champions. No, I'm looking forward to TakeOver more. So, dicks to that, I'm looking forward to night three, which is A block action of the G1. That's tomorrow. You can eat my ass, I don't care. That's just me. Yeah, follow me on Twitter. The handle is right there. That way. That's the one. Look at that. That's me right there. Or you can follow the show at the Hot Pod at THEHOPPOD. If you like this video or any of the others I've put out on YouTube, cool beans. Hit like, smash, subscribe. Let's try and get some numbers up there. You know, I want to get the subscribers up. I'm not that bad at this, am I? Yeah, I hope not. If I am, tell me. I'll try to be better. Just don't be a douchebag about it. But yeah, if you are on Twitter and you do want to follow me, make sure you follow the bodyslam.net boys. We are there doing some good work. A whole lot of things coming out. News, opinions, views, reviews, live coverage of all the main stuff, which is good. They've got their official podcast on the website, The Push. They've done some really good interviews. They had Vampiro, Danny Jordan, Gregory Iron as well. And that was their first three episodes. Yep. So keep up to date with that stuff. Yeah, Cass the owner, he's on there with Don Mellon. And yeah, all the new stuff is headed by Chris Dees, lead editor. It's good stuff. Good stuff. So yeah, just keep an eye on that stuff. And yeah, I'm just going to keep churning out content. If you want to watch or you like what I'm putting out, cool. I appreciate you. Thank you very much. If you don't, tell me why. I'll try and be better. And this has been all positive. G1, all positive. Happy days. My Raw and SmackDown review, well, depending on what SmackDown's like, but the Raw portion of it, oh man, I'm not holding back on that shit. They wasted 3 hours of my day. My fuck is gonna hear about that shit. It was horrible. But that's for another day, that's for later on. But yeah, that was night 1 and 2, and look forward to night 3 and 4 of G1. Hope everyone's staying safe, doing what they're meant to do, masking up, social distancing, doing the right thing, just do your bit. Our case numbers here in Victoria and Australia are coming down, thankfully, so we might get an end to lockdown, like in 34 and being told, you know, you can't go outside your house after 9 p.m. at night. I'm an adult. Being told what to do, I don't like it, but I have to do the right thing. So Yeah, they want us back to normal by Christmas. I want us back to normal by Christmas. And I've got an Italian wife and a 3-year-old. Good luck telling any of them you can't do anything family related on Christmas Day. That ain't happening, so we are doing the right thing. Hope you're doing the right thing. I'm going to continue to do the right thing and put this show out for you guys. As I said, hit like, smash subscribe, leave a comment down below, alternatively hit me up on the socials. I'll be back later in the week. Till then, bye.